Hello, aspirants. Looking at current affairs for 6th March, the news items that we have picked up from the Hindu newspaper are these 14. We'll look at them in detail. The first one, Sikh shot at in Washington. So this is a third incident of violence against an Indian American, which we are seeing in USA in recent few days. The first one was of Kansas shooting in which an Indian engineer, Kuchi Butla, he lost his life. The second incident, again, the shopkeeper, an Indian American, was shot at and died. This is a third incident now, again an Indian American involved, and the shooter here too yelled, "Go back to your country." But he was shot in his arm and is safe now. So this incident becomes significant in the context of the alleged hate crimes and the policies which the present US administration under President Donald Trump is undertaking. So what is the status of Indian Americans there is important. Plus, another significant point is that two out of these three were actually American nationals. So this one is also American national. That's what, when this statement was given to him, "Go back to your country," he shouted back that this is my country, because he's an American national, a US citizen now. So what steps can India take in this matter too is again not clear, because of course, hate crimes against people of Indian origin is taking place, but they are US citizens. So what steps can Indian government take in that matter? There are limitations there. Then the next news item is AP government wants INS Virat turned into luxury hotel. So INS Virat, this is the oldest aircraft carrier of the Indian Navy. So it's a ship, Indian naval ship, and it's an aircraft carrier. So it's a huge ship, you can see, which can carry aircrafts too, and it is to retire. So what steps need to be taken? It has retired actually. So this, what steps to be taken to, what should be done next with this? So the its predecessor too, it was INS Vikrant. That was also a question raised there, that what should be done with this ship. There were various proposals coming in of converting it into a museum or some such initiative taken. But since no decision could be finalized effectively, and the Navy could not keep that ship, docking that ship, that is also taking up space and the logistics issues are involved. So that is why INS Vikrant eventually had to go to the scrapyard, and it was scrapped. So again, this Virat, the oldest aircraft carrier presently of the Indian Navy, again, there's no clarity of what would be done, whether it should be converted into a luxury hotel or should it eventually go to the scrapyard and broken up. So in the scrapyard too, the ship would be broken up and all its metals, non-metals, whatever are used in its body can be reused. So they are extracted and reused. So that is a complete industry. We have discussed this earlier too. That is there in Alang, Gujarat. That is a major hub in India. So even ships from abroad, developed countries, also come here and are broken up here. So that is the scrapyard which eventually it may go into, or can it be used in any other fruitful way that has been looked into. So the Andhra Pradesh government has given a proposal of converting it into an entertainment hub in Visakhapatnam. So it should be a joint venture between the state government and government of India, and some such initiative can be taken. So Defense Ministry is looking into this proposal, and we'll have to wait and watch what happens on this. It's a huge ship. It's an aircraft carrier. Means it's weighing 27,800 tons. One ton is 1,000 kg. 27,800 into 1,000 kgs. So that's its weight. It's the world's oldest aircraft carrier in service. It was actually a British Navy aircraft carrier. HMS Holmes was its original name. It served in the British Navy for 25 years, from 1959 to 84, after which it was refurbished and then commissioned into the Indian Navy in 1987. So this is INS Virat. And Vikrant was India's first aircraft carrier. So it was there, had to be maintained at Mumbai for 17 years, because no decision could be taken about what should be done, whether it should be converted into a museum or not. And eventually it was sent to the scrapyard in 2014. So this took 17 years of indecisiveness, and finally it went to the scrapyard. So what would be the future of Virat, what fate it would meet, we'll have to wait and watch. The next news item is, Center launches survey on gangetic dolphins. So the central government has launched an across the river survey of gangetic dolphin, which is an endangered species. It lives in fresh water, so it's also called the gives an understanding of how clean river Ganga is. So an enumeration would be done of this. It's also called the national aquatic animal of India now. That status has also been accorded to it. So this will be undertaken through the Wildlife Institute of India. So this will be part of the Namami Gange program. So this is the program launched by the present BJP government at the center. So National Mission for Clean Ganga, NMCG, this is the nodal authority for this also, Namami Gange also. And this is the authority which is asking Wildlife Institute of India to conduct this survey. And it would look into enumeration, means numbering, listing, a numbering of not just the gangetic dolphins, but also other aquatic animals like gharials, turtles also. So this survey will be taken up. A scientific data would be coming out from this, and it will be helping in improving the quality of river water too. So this would be undertaken. This is gangetic dolphin. It's a mammal, and it says it's said to represent the purity of Holy Ganga, as it can only survive in pure and fresh water. So this has been called the national aquatic animal. The status was given to it in 2010. This is Namami Gange too. So for Ganga and its tributaries, this is River Ganga flowing through the states. You can see Uttar Pradesh, Uttarakhand, Bihar, a little of Jharkhand and West Bengal. Then it goes into Bangladesh. And this boundary is the Ganga Basin boundary. So these are its various tributaries also shown here. So this is Namami Gange, for which for a 5-year period, 20,000 crore was allotted. Now it has become double to 40,000 crore too. So this is a 100% centrally funded scheme. Earlier too, we had Clean Ganga Mission had been initiated. Even the National Mission for Clean Ganga was established before this. Namami Gange is a 2015 initiative. So National Mission for Clean Ganga is an authority established. So for Ganga cleaning, there have been initiatives taken and money spent already since 1985, when the first Ganga Action Plan, GAP, was initiated by Rajiv Gandhi government. And after that, various phases also came up. National River Conservation Plan was brought in. And now the refurbished version, Namami Gange, has been launched by the present government, budgeted for 5 years. So we'll have to wait and watch what happens. Even this Namami Gange is 100% centrally funded scheme. So it has varied from 50-50 scheme, means 50 center, 50 states, to 100% centrally funded. Then again, it went to 70-30 scheme. And now again, Namami Gange is 100% centrally funded scheme. We have seen a lot about Ganga cleaning too. The National Green Tribunal has also made statements that so much money has been spent, so many years have passed, but Ganga still remains polluted. So this are the some of the initiatives which have to be undertaken under Namami Gange to clean up River Ganga. So sewerage infrastructure has to be established. We have seen STP, sewage treatment plants need to be established. There should be a clear understanding of how much sewage is generated and how many plants would be needed at what spots. So there should be scientific aspect associated here in how to set up plants and at what capacity. That also we have discussed recently, that National Green Tribunal has rebuked the authorities for not undertaking a scientific analysis and setting up STPs. So that is sewage infrastructure, riverfront management. So management at the riverfront so that pollution does not take place. Industrial pollution, it should be treated and then drained as such, if at all. Solid waste management again has to be there. A viral Ganga, so a viral Ganga as it is called. So this for clean Ganga. Research and development to be undertaken for this. A Ganga task force has also been established, which would look into that people don't pollute River Ganga. This is Ganga task force awareness creation, that is important so that pollution does not take place, and biodiversity conservation. So biodiversity conservation is basically what this article is also about the aquatic animals in River Ganga, gangetic dolphin and other gharial turtles. The Wildlife Institute of India, which will undertake this survey, is an autonomous institution under Ministry of Environment. So it will be undertaking this. It undertakes wildlife research studies, and this survey will also be undertaken by it. The next news item is Jalyukt Shivar Yojana Unsustainable, says study. So this is Maharashtra government's program, a scheme for drought proofing, means in cases of drought, scarcity of water, there should be enough water resource available. So under this, farm ponds are being made. So even under MGNREGS, Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme, various farm ponds are being developed. So that is the work, because it generates manual work and payment is done. So the rural infrastructure developed, done, is farm ponds being built. So these farm ponds being dug is actually done unscientifically. That has come out through a study presently. That is why it has become, this complete scheme has become unsustainable. So this is a study conducted at Hivergaon, Pawasa. This is a backwater village of Ahmednagar district. So drought is a huge concern here too. So what has happened is there has been indiscriminate digging of farm ponds. So such that the groundwater extraction is taking place at such a stage, such a rate that it cannot be replenished. So that would become difficult, because even these farm ponds where have to be established, they should not be at a very high level. So that should be at a lower level, low-lying areas. So that has not been looked into. Even it is seen that none of them have inlets and outlets. So farm ponds become temporary isolated regions. They should be having inlets from groundwater and outlets so that they drain, the continuous groundwater flow continues. So that aspect is not looked into too. Because originally in the Yojana, it is expected it should be there, but it is not present in as per the study. So in none of the farm ponds, it says in Hivergaon, have these inlets and outlets, which are envisioned in the scheme. Then also because of these farm ponds, now farmers are shifting to horticulture. So Hivergaon farmers undertaking horticulture rather than these traditional crops like bajra, wheat, pulses, onion is again resulting in more water utilization. And this is not sustainable. So that is that these are cash crops, horticulture crops. So that is that soil conservation is not undertaken. That is very important for groundwater recharge. So if it would result into the rocks being exposed, then there would be no percolation of water, groundwater recharge would not take place, and this would be just a scheme for holding water. So that is being looked into again, that this is important, because rainwater harvesting etc. also is possible through these farm points, but then there should be river water percolation, the rocks should not be exposed, soil conservation is also important. So that is being coming out from this study. It says that 13,950 ponds were dug between 2014 and 2016 under National Horticulture Mission. This Jalyukt Shivar Yojana. So this is Jalyukt Shivar Yojana, Rashtriya Krishi Vikas Yojana, and also under MGNREHS. So these many ponds are being dug. 13,950 and 24,700. But then they have to be sustainable. Just digging for ponds is not important. Ensuring that they are sustainable, groundwater recharge would also take place is important. Then the next news item is dry Kolleru turns birds away. So this is Kolleru Lake, a freshwater lake in Andhra Pradesh, where because of summer now, temperature is increasing, a major portion of this lake has dried up. So this is a drought-like situation which will be having its consequences for the people here too, plus thousands of birds which come here during the wintering season, especially these pelicans and painted storks are mentioned. So they would be suffering as well. So they come here. Kolleru Lake. Many of them go to Pulikat Lake also. Pulikat Lake is also in Andhra Pradesh. It is a lagoon. So it's a brackish water lake. So the way we have Chilika Lake, this is a Pulikat Lake, a lagoon. So that is there. Chilika Lake is in Orisha. So here in Kolleru Lake too, this is Atapaka Bird Sanctuary, which is located in Kolleru Lake. So in this sanctuary, there have been the biggest grey pelican habitat, is called one of the biggest grey pelican habitat in the world. So last year there had been many pelicans coming here. So what would be the status this year has to be seen now, because of the lake portions drying up now. Then the next news item is India runs out of life-saving HIV drug for children. These are children living with HIV. They have written a desperate letter for the life-saving drug for them, which is lopinavir. So this drug has been withdrawn presently, and they have written this letter to Prime Minister Narendra Modi asking for help. So this lopinavir syrup is a child-friendly HIV drug. The sole manufacturer of this in India is Cipla, the pharmaceutical company, and it has withdrawn this drug presently because of non-payment of dues. So the health ministry has failed to pay dues to Cipla for 2014. So NACO, National AIDS Control Organization, has also failed to convince the company in participating in the bids which it invites annually. So that has resulted in lack of this drug being present in the market too. The government also said that if Cipla is not providing it, it should be procured from the market. But since it is the sole manufacturer, it has gone out of production also. So it's not available in retail markets too. So what would be the steps taken by the government on this matter has to be seen now. The next news item is Aadhaar data not misused. So this is UIDAI, Unique Identification Authority of India, which says that there is no misuse of Aadhaar biometric information taking place, no identity or financial theft is taking place. The personal data is secure with UIDAI. So this has been in news because recently there was breach of Aadhaar data reported and UIDAI had sent notices to three firms for possible unauthorized authentication attempt and storing of biometric data. So there's a complete Aadhaar Act which has been passed now. So this, under this, only authenticated bodies can save and store this biometric data and can use it. So there are restrictions here too. Plus no unauthentic collection of biometric data is also allowed. So that on that also UIDAI has initiated cases. And presently, since it created a hue and cry, especially on the social media about safety of Aadhaar data, because there's around 111 crore of the Indian population which has already registered itself under Aadhaar. Many have also around 3 crores have their accounts, bank accounts linked to Aadhaar. So when such a huge number of population has this data here, there is a need to safeguard it as well. So that is why UIDAI is now saying that the safety precautions are taken. The UIDAI uses the best of the security encryption technologies. That is the security feature which is there. The data is encrypted so that it cannot be stolen or tampered with. So this is ensured. It says we are using one of the world's most advanced encryption technology in transmission and storage of data. So it's safe. There have been no cases of breaches reported in the last 7 years. There have been few one-off instances. Otherwise, it's safe. Also, it says that we are continuously updating the security parameters also and undertaking security audits to ensure that the data remains safe. So this is there. Plus, under the Aadhaar Act, unauthorized capture of iris or fingerprint data or storage or replay of biometrics also or any kind of misuse is a criminal offense and can be prosecuted. So that step is also being taken. So you can see around 111 crore have Aadhaar and 4.47 crore have opened bank accounts using Aadhaar eKYC. So that is there. Using Aadhaar, government has also benefited a lot because it has saved around 49,000 crore in the last 2.5 years. So this has savings have come because of the direct benefit transfer. So LPG subsidies under the Pahal scheme, direct benefit transfer takes place. Even MGNREGS payments take place through direct transfers to bank accounts. Scholarships, pensions also, we have seen that they have been brought in under Aadhaar direct transfer. So that is resulting in savings for the government. The next news item is Colombo not to allow foreign judges. So we have been seeing about Sri Lanka in the last few days. It has been in news. The UN has raised its a concern that because Sri Lanka is not undertaking reparation initiatives for the war crimes which have already been undertaken during the civil war. LTT got eliminated, but there are allegations of war crimes on both sides, against LTT also and against the government. That is the soldiers, the armed forces here too. So there's a need for impartial justice being provided here. So that is why there is a suggestion that hybrid courts should be established. Hybrid courts were that courts which include even the local judges as well as international judges. So this has been a recommendation of international organizations to UN as well as the committee which Sri Lanka had also established on this purpose. It had also spoken in favor of hybrid courts, but the government is completely against it. It says that no international judge would be allowed to investigate in these alleged war crimes and atrocities, and no soldier would be prosecuted. So it says we are vowing that no soldier would be prosecuted. So this step being taken to safeguard the soldiers, even if they have done something wrong on the part of themselves. So this is being highlighted here presently. The present Sri Lankan government is completely against any prosecution of soldiers. So such safeguards are generally taken in India too. There is this concern for the law which we have, AFSPA, Armed Forces Special Powers Act. So special powers are given to them. They cannot be prosecuted under the government authorizes their prosecution in the courts of law. So this results in immunity being provided to the soldiers. Then they get the power to undertake any kind of action and being assured that there would be no action taken against them. The next news item is small businesses lobby for rules to increase liquidity. So this is small and medium enterprises. So they have also been listed. Many of them have got listed on the stocks. So there is a separate section, segment developed for them by the National Stock Exchange and the Bombay Stock Exchange as well, BSE and NSE. So the market participants here who are there, they want more liquidity as such. So more liquidity means that institutional and retail investors should be more attracted to small and medium enterprises stocks. So for this, what they want is the present limit which has been there, minimum lot size. So this minimum lot size means the minimum amount that an investor has to put in to trade in the shares of a company. So this minimum lot size presently is 1 lakh rupees. So now it's been 5 years that they say that the stocks have been listed. So after this, now it should be so that retail investors should also be allowed in investing in these SMEs. So for that, they should be allowed that even if one share as such should be there, there should not be any minimum lot size as such is what their demand is. So since this has been started since 2012, separate platform has been provided for SMEs by both BSE and NSE. So what they want now is that the retailers, they say, understand that this is not for short-term gains, but this is an investment which has to be undertaken. So if there are potential retail investors and institutional investors, they should not have this minimum lot size requirement mandated, and they should be able to invest in the small and medium enterprises. But the BSE, But the SEBI has always been keen that the guidelines which have been put in, there is this minimum lot trading lot size ensured intentionally so that retail investors are kept out. Because it says that SMEs have higher risk compared to other companies on the main board, not the SME segment. So that is why this limit has been put in. The next news item is Center gives nod to sell 3 sale plants. So this is Steel Authority of India Limited. So 3 special steel units which it has: Alloy Steel Plants, Salem Steel Plants, and Visvesvaraya Iron and Steel Plants. So they would be sold out. So that approval has been given by the center. Sale, you should know, is a Maharatna PSU. What is a Maharatna? We'll look at that also. So this sale would result in disinvestment. It's actually a disinvestment which will result in money being brought in for the government. Government has also budgeted that in this financial year, it would raise 15,000 crores from strategic disinvestment. So strategic disinvestment means a disinvestment in which government would lose its majority stakeholder status. So that is called strategic disinvestment. In SAIL, presently, Center holds 75% stake, and SAIL is the largest steel producer in the country. This is the 3-4 categories for PSUs, public sector undertakings: Maharatna, Navratna, Mini Ratna category 1, and Mini Ratna category 2. So these are the eligibility criteria for them, means based on the annual net profit. It should be around 5,000 crore, 3 years average annual net profit. Even their net worth is given here, or average annual turnover for 3 years. So if they fulfill these criteria, then they are called Maharatna. And similarly, criteria are there for Navratna, Mini Ratna category 1 and 2. So that is at that scale, at that level. So this is the highest order, highest status, then it goes down. So this eligibility, once they are eligible, they get benefits. So benefits for investments are there. So they are free to decide on investments up to 15% of their net worth in a project, or around 1,000 to 5,000 crores. So they are free to decide these investments. So that is the benefit which they get, and so on for others too. So these Maharatnas which we have in the country presently, apart from SAIL, which is in use presently, these are the others: Coal India Limited, Indian Oil Corporation, NTPC, ONGC, GAIL India, and BHEL, Bharat Heavy Electrical Limited. Then the next news item is policy drags e-commerce exports. So e-commerce is actually promoted by India under Foreign Trade Policy 2015-20, but still there are several restrictions and challenges for these e-commerce websites. So that has been highlighted here, and the demands which they are making presently. So under the FTP, Foreign Trade Policy, we have this Merchandise Export from India Scheme, MEIS. So under this scheme, e-commerce exports from India abroad are encouraged, but to a limited extent. So there are for limited number of goods, that is low value goods like handloom products, leather footwear, toys, books, fashion garments. Here only for these limited products it's encouraged, and that also up to a free on board value is of up to 25,000 rupees per consignment. So here they say these are limitations. It should be increased. They should be allowed for other products also, like including jewelry, etc. So other bigger finished products should also be encouraged for export through e-commerce. Plus also they say that this 25,000 limit should be increased to at least up to 5 lakh. So these are the demands being made. The rewards which they get under this scheme are that they have freely transferable duty credit script. So benefits from imports of imports of goods can be acquired, capital goods can be acquired through this. So that is the benefit which they get. And they say a major disincentive. So apart from the scheme, actually there's a disincentive because the buyers send an when the buyers send an item back to the country, it is considered as an import and an import duty is charged on it. So this aspect has to be looked into. So when the product is coming back from abroad to the country, it should not be imposed, have import duty imposed on it. Also, another demand which they make is that these commercial courier through which they send this, they are ticked as samples or gifts and not as commercial shipment. So this results in these documents or these transactions not being recognized and acknowledged by VAT authorities, value added tax authorities. So then the refund which they have to get, that is not taking place for VAT and service tax. So that also commercial shipment category should be there for them. E-commerce exporters is another demand which they are making. So e-commerce is developing at a faster pace all across the globe. Even recently, the reports which had come, World Trade Organization had said that e-commerce services are presently worth 22 trillion globally and they are growing fastest in emerging economies. So India, China, here the e-commerce industry is growing at a very fast pace. Even in India, it says that eBay has around 25,000 Indian companies registered on it. So eBay is the American multinational e-commerce company. And also within India, there are around 2 lakh Indian business-to-commerce exporters who are exporting abroad through e-commerce. So that is why there is a need to develop this e-commerce industry for exports also. And government provisions should be there, schemes should be there favoring them and encouraging them. So that is the demand being made here. Then the next news item is law enforcement in the digital era. So this is about the push to digital economy post demonetization and the consequent expected increase in cyber crimes. So anyway, cyber crimes in India have been rising since 2011 to 2014. If you look at the study from ASSOCHAM, it says 300% increase in cyber crimes have taken place in India. The national agency which is maintaining cyber security in the country is CERT-IN, that is Computer Emergency Response Team India. So this as initiative has been taken. There have many cybersecurity incidents registered, also cases registered as such. But to increase our capabilities, what we need, the best thing which could work is public-private partnership. Because in the public sector, recruitment at such a high scale and providing technical training can be too much to ask for. So at least a public-private partnership is a practical initiative which can be taken in to combat cybercrime. So a similar initiative which has been taken in India to NASSCOM affiliated Data Security Council of India. This has set up cyber labs in different countries and imparts in different cities in India and it imparts training. So such a similar model can be scaled up throughout the nation too. So this initiative and bringing in private sector here to provide training and such initiatives taken will ensure that cyber security threat can be tackled in the country. Then the next news item is struggle to fight ultra-rare diseases made more difficult. This is the last news item. This is about lysosomal storage disorders, LSDs. So there are 23 diagnosed and registered patients in Delhi. So this is a genetic disorder. It's a rare disease. So under this disorder, there are around 45 to 50 diseases. So lysosome, you should know, is present in the nucleus. So these lysosomes, you can see the image shown here. These act as floating garbage disposals. They are present in the cells. So these floating garbage disposals for the cells digest and recycle cellular waste products and the consumed material. So in many patients, we see that these lysosomal storage disorders takes place and that there are many types of diseases under it. So the medicines for them are not there. Only less than 10 have treatment available for them out of 45-50, and the medicines which are there for those for which treatment is available, they are to be taken lifelong and they can cost anything from minimum 5 lakh a month. So that is a huge amount of burden involved. So these patients are also suffering. The major disease, which is most common form of LSD, is Gaucher's disease. So this is a genetic disorder that causes fatty deposits to build up in organs and bones, because lysosomal functioning does not take place. So fatty deposits take place. So this, the enzyme which is responsible for breakdown of these certain type of fat molecules, is not present, and that is why this undigested fat gets filled up. So it primarily affects the liver, spleen and bone marrow. So for this, the treatment which is there is enzyme replacement therapy. This is the most effective treatment for LSDs and is available in India. But then the treatment is unaffordable because of the costs involved. So on that, this is an article that there should be some initiative taken to ensure that this becomes affordable medication. So these you can see, lysosomal storage disorder. These lysosomes are sets of enzymes within the cells that digest large molecules and pass the fragments on to other parts of the cell for recycling. So you can see the major diseases, the most common, Gaucher's, and the others too. The drugs which are there, but the costs are unaffordable. So these are the news items. Thank you.